Joel 2, find the 12th verse. Actually, we're going to take it from the 11th or 10th. The Lord thunders at the head of his army. His forces are beyond number. And mighty is the army that obeys his command. Come on, somebody say, we're a mighty army. We're a mighty army. The day of the Lord is great. It is dreadful. Who can endure it? Even now declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping and mourning. Rend your heart and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. Who knows? He may turn and relent and leave behind a blessing, grain offering and drink offerings for the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion, declare a holy fast, call a sacred assembly, gather the people, consecrate the assembly, bring together the elders, gather the children, those nursing at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her chamber. Let the priests who minister before the Lord weep between the portico and the altar. Let them say, spare your people, O Lord. Do not make your inheritance an object of scorn, a byword among the nations. Why should they say among the people, where is their God? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for what you've done in the first service and what you'll do even now. Holy Spirit, come and anoint these lips of clay yet again. Pour out upon us and give us living understanding. May we never be the same, God, because your word goes forth and doesn't return void. I bind the works of darkness and every hindering spirit that would try to stop up the ears of your people. I pray, God, give us ears to hear and a heart to respond. Not only us here in this room, but those online, those that'll listen at a later date on all of our platforms. God, have your way. In Jesus' name. Come on, put your hand on your own heart and ask God to speak to you. Just use your own words. Go ahead. Speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I'm in the midst, or I should say, we are in the midst of a series on vision. And I'm going to place this message in that series. I've entitled it, Responding to the Coming Storm. Responding to the Coming Storm. If you listen to prophetic voices across the land, across the nations, you hear a unity in the word of the Lord going forth, that there's coming a storm, there's coming difficulty, there's coming problems. Really, you don't have to be much of a prophet to know that. I'm 57, feel like I'm 27, but in the years that I've been alive, I have seen more fires, more earthquakes, more wars, more rumors of war, more pestilence, 100,000 plus people wiped out by a tsunami. I mean, just think about your lifetime, and if you're in your 80s or maybe in your 90s in your hearing, it's increasing. Matthew 24 says this. You'll hear verse 6 of wars and rumors of war, but see to it that you're not alarmed. Come on, somebody say, I'm not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be famine and earthquakes in various places. All of these are the birth pains. The what? The birth pains. We are in the birth pains. Raise your hand if you've brought forth a child, a woman here. Of course, you'd be a woman because men can't birth children. Sorry to have to say that, but it's true. That might be a revelation for you, but it's true. Not identifying as one. If you're an actual woman, you can give birth many times. Sometimes there's delay. Sometimes you have spiritual children. It's difficult, I'm to understand, to birth a child. Birth pains. Prophet Jim LaFoon said to his 90-something-year-old mother during COVID, who had been through a world war, been through the Dust Bowl, been through Korean War, Vietnam War, been through all kinds of hardship, difficulties. He says to his mother, "Mom, it's really hard right now." And she says, "Well, son, it really isn't." How many of you know she, her definition of what hard is was very different than what somebody's struggling through COVID. Not that I'm trying to diminish if you've, you know, lost somebody during COVID. I understand COVID was real. I'm getting it 16 times, I think. Just kidding. Three, maybe. I don't know. I might have been in the cold, too. There's wars, rumors of wars. There's birth pains. We're in the birth pains, clearly. There will come a day when it'll be over, but we're in it right now. And the prophetic voices are saying there's coming a storm, there's coming more difficulty, there's coming pain, there's coming problems, there's coming turmoil, there's coming upset, there's coming food shortages, there's coming another pandemic or a plandemic, I'm not sure what it is, but there's coming problems. James says, consider it not strange. We should respond in a way that is very different than unbelievers should respond. We're in a season that Jews call Teshuvah. Teshuvah is a 40-day period between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. It actually started, it's these days of repentance, and it started on August 16th, goes through September 24th. Teshuvah is a place where you repent and you examine your life and you prepare for the new year. In the Hebrew understanding, he says, "Well, I'm not a Jew." Okay, I'm not either that I know of. However, Jesus is a Jew, and God chose the Jewish people to reveal his language to. It's the only language in all of the world that's actually created by God. And the lettering and the alphabet of the whole thing, and it's changed a little bit from ancient times, but it's a language that was written by God. It's the language of God, a Hebrew. Hebrew. And it says in the Old Testament that he has these times and seasons, these appointed times, and that they're actually to be celebrated in memorial for like forever. So these seasons and times are important. Say they're important. Okay, they don't save you. They actually point to the Messiah. They're pictures of what's to come. And I've preached on that at other times. We're in this season where there's storms and coming storms. How to handle regional, national, global crisis as a believer? How do you handle that? First thing here, God's power is released in partnership as we pray. It's interesting that if you look at the life of Jesus, it says that he ever lives to make intercession. God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son. He needed somebody fully God, fully man, yet sinless to redeem mankind. Fascinating. I always thought it was like apostasy and just folk theology. When Satan says to Jesus, "If you bow down and worship me, I'll give you all the kingdoms of the world." I thought, what a liar. But in actual fact, the title deed of the earth was turned over to him by Adam. And if you understand jurisdiction and justice and righteousness and the economy of God, God actually had to send someone. He sent his son, fully God, fully man, the three in one God, one God. Everybody say there's one God. Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one God, but there's a mystery in what Tertullian coined is the Trinity. You don't see Trinity in Scripture, but there is a three in one God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Just like you're made in his image, you have spirit, soul, and body. So he sends his son to die on the home playing field of Satan, the god of this age, God small g. The world was turned over to him because Satan basically duped Adam and Eve, and he forfeited the title deed, losing his right, and in dying he died, and death entered the world. Sin entered the world through one man, and sin would then leave the world through all those who would believe on the last Adam, the Redeemer. The fulfillment of the seed of the woman in the book of Genesis, and I might have shot over a whole bunch of your heads, but you just hang on, I'll make it plain here. The seed of the woman fulfilled in the birth of Jesus, sinless Jesus, the Nazarene out of Egypt, I've called my son. And he partners with us who are the redeemed. We have a delegated authority. So what's terrifying to me is if I've been given delegated authority and I don't use it, then what God wants to do in the earth might not happen. You say, well, that's not true because God, no, you don't know the word. So don't know Jesus is coming back no matter what happens. Absolutely right. You could backslide to hell or you could pray and fast. He's still coming back. In actual fact, you can hasten his return, says the New Testament. You can quicken, speed his return. The gospel has to be preached. There's certain things that have to happen before that event, but that event will take place. The new heaven and new earth is going to happen. Whether you pray, whether you fast, whether you serve God or not, there is going to come a new heaven and a new earth. Satan, the ugly one, Lucifer, will be cast into the lake of fire. That's going to happen whether you serve God or not. However, there is this paradox, this mystery that certain things don't happen if we don't pray, if we don't preach, if we don't prophesy, if we don't take action. The way that God releases his power in the earth is through a partnership with you and me, with his people, with his redeemed. And that to me is absolutely amazing. God opens doors of blessing. He opens doors, he closes doors in response to our prayer. And I would add, in your notes, right, and to our worship, because worship and prayer really go together, and worship is really the highest form of prayer. And in the book of Revelation, the harp and the bowl are mixed to two. You see the two. That's kind of amazing. That the way that you live can either open up a door to release angelic power, the kingdom of God. The way that you pray, the way that you worship can release the government of God in the earth. Or your lack of prayer, your lack of walking in authority, your yielding to sin can open up a door to the devil, to the demonic, to demon power. And you can blame God as much as you want to, but you are responsible for which door you open. God has given mankind this great glory and the power of choice. In fact, it's called the glory of man, theologically called the glory of man, because you have such power, such dignity, such majesty that you can choose yourself straight to the lake of fire. God will not interrupt your choices, although he does things along the way as expressions of his discipline, expressions of his judgment. He does things to help guide you and direct you in hopes that though you're rejecting him and denying him, it's his patience, it's his kindness that leads us to repentance. And that's a beautiful thing. You are so special and so significant, this glory of man, the power to be able to choose. So special, so significant that Jesus said to the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the couldn't sees, the wouldn't sees, he says, you nullify the word of God through your tradition. And he defines that. He says, you go over land and sea, and then you bring these people in, and you make them twice the son of hell as you are. He's one of my most favorite preachers. In fact, I'm going to say it. Jesus is my favorite preacher. How'd you like being called twice the son of hell? Nice. Thanks, Pastor Jesus. He says, you and many other things you do, you nullify the word, let there be light. Light didn't have a choice. There's light because God spoke, the Creator spoke, and there's light, and we still have it today. And yet we are so significant, this glory of man, this ability to choose. You can choose to line your life up with the word and then actually see the word released in your life, or you can choose to line your life up with Satan. Line your life up with disobedience. I love that song that we were singing. I want to sing that at the end, please, worship team. Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? The fact is, by denying what the Lord can do and not getting in agreement with the word and decreeing and speaking it out, there's this mystery of the courts of heaven. I challenge you to go study it. This council of heaven, the Elohim. Fascinating. Psalms talks about it. There's decrees that are made in the court of heaven. And when God's people understand the decree of heaven and they take that decree and they speak it forth and they take action on it, it changes things. Why would you say all that, Pastor? Because in the midst of crisis, we're not going to wallow around on our back and hope that God just comes and rescues us when he's given us authority to change things. God opens doors and closes doors in response to our prayer. James 4:2, you do not have because you do not ask. Matthew 17:21, this kind does not come out except by prayer and fasting. Isaiah 30:18-19 in the NAS version, the Lord longs to be gracious to you, and therefore he waits on high to have compassion on you. He will surely be gracious to you at the sound of your cry. At the sound of your cry. At the sound of your cry, he longs to release his power at the sound of your cry that you never make. Oh no, some of you are making it. But God is trying to summon and gather his church, his people, who will not be in a lackadaisical, half-hearted, apathetic position of fear, crippled by false news, fake news, and every other kind of nonsense that's out there, and shrivel back and just, oh, Jesus, oh, save us, God. For the love of God, rise up in your God-given, blood-bought right and take, take authority. Close the door to the devil. Open the door to the blessings of God through your obedience, through your prayer. You are not a victim. Come on, say, I'm not a victim. Bump your neighbor and say, you're a victor. That's what you are. Tell him, you're a victor. Tell your other person, you're a victor. That's what you are. Victory in Jesus, my Savior, for he sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood, precious blood. He bought me and I knew it, and all my love is to him. He plunged me into victory beneath the cleansing, neath the cleansing, neath the cleansing blood. That victim Christianity thing, Jesus help me. You know what it is? It's folk theology. Again, Pastor Karen been impacting me with her systematic theology class she's been taking. She wrote a paper, 5 different types of theology. Folk theology is one of them. And most people in the church, maybe not this church, I'd like to think not this church, folk theology is they make up stuff. I remember years ago we had somebody that said, Christmas trees are from the devil. I said, yeah, fundamentally they are, but we've redeemed it. Well, you can't do that. I said, no, yes, we can. They said, no. It says in scripture that you can't do that. I'm like, where does it say that? And she says, the person who puts up a tree and puts lights and ornaments on it goes to hell. I said, where is that? It's in there. I said, no, it isn't. Now, we're not going to sing O Tannenbaum here. The tree is a picture of the resurrection of Christ, cut down, resurrected, green, evergreen, eternity. He who hung on a tree became a curse, so we've redeemed it. Not going to find us worshiping the tree, but we are going to use them. Amen. We give gifts because the greatest gift is Jesus, and he wasn't born at Christmas. We understand that, but come on. Folk theology, most people don't know you've got power. You have power when you pray. You have power when you stand. You're not a victim. You're a You're a victor. Ezekiel 22:30, I sought for a man among them who would make up a wall to stand in the gap before men on behalf of the land that I should not destroy, but found no one. Exodus 32:19, the Lord said to Moses, indeed, this is a stiff-necked people. Now, therefore, let me alone, that my wrath may burn hot against them, that I may consume them. Then Moses, verse 11, pleaded with the Lord, turn your fierce wrath, relent from harming your people. Verse 14, so the Lord relented. Well, what would happen if Moses did? Now, that's the Old Testament. There are people that will not get saved. Our country will not turn. There's things that will not happen. Yes, he's coming. Yes, Satan's going to the lake of fire. Yes, new heaven and new earth. There are things that won't happen unless you pray and worship and release a decree. It is God's will for men to be saved. It's God's will for men to be redeemed. And prayer really is the main way. Prayer and worship is really the main way that God has chosen to release his power in the earth. I said this in yesterday. This is a message that I preached to our leaders on Saturday, but I've reworked it because I had so many people say, oh, I wish the whole church was here. And so I felt impressed as text after text, phone call after phone call. And then finally, Pastor Karen said, that was a great word. That's like the word of the Lord. You need to be to preach that. And so I'm re-preaching it, reworked here now in the second service. There are many people that enjoy prayer and worship because they get touched by the Lord. And you should get touched by the Lord. And I'm so thankful for the comfort that comes from God. When I was younger in my faith, I'm beginning to grow up now, I would enter in and worship and pray because I love the touch of the Holy Spirit. I meant just, oh, touch me, feel me. Oh, do it again. Electricity or waves or wind, many different kinds of manifestations of his power upon me as a man, or upon you, upon us as humans. It's beautiful. And those things always said to me, I love you, I'm with you. But then I began to realize that he wanted me to mature in my intercession. And it was more than just about me having the power of the Holy Spirit on me. It was about me now taking authority and beginning to make the decree from heaven to release it in the earth. If the church would do that in the midst of crisis, there would be a great release of his power. If we would do that in our schools, we would do that in our homes, our marriages would be different, our children would be different. So many people have a folk theology and have been lulled to sleep that God's just sovereign. He's going to do what he wants to, when he wants to, whoever he wants to, but they miss their responsibility. You have a responsibility. Come on, raise a hand to heaven and say, I've got responsibility. All right, understanding God in the midst of global crisis. And this is not in your notes, but I'll repeat it. I've said it before. Four causes of crisis and hardship. These are, like, it sounds like hyperbole, but there's only four causes to hardship and trials. Are you ready? Here they are. You write it on the back of your notes if you want to. Number one, Hebrews 12, God's discipline, heaven's discipline, chastisement from heaven. God corrects. God does send storms. God does judge. Okay, Jonah. The storm came from God. Some people were caught up in it, but it was to get his disobedient prophet to obey and to get to Nineveh. He wanted to go to Tarshish and enjoy a daiquiri on the beach. But God wanted to direct him to Nineveh. He refused to go because he hated Nineveh. I hate them. And he goes and he's still rebellious, but he preaches the word, smelling like a fish after he's swallowed by a whale. You think the whale was hardship? God sent a fish. It's not a whale. We call it a whale, but it's a fish. God sent a fish. See, some of you are in difficulty right now because you've been disobedient. You need to repent and get back on track. I got like three or four amens and a come on somewhere. So you're like, oh, I bind this. I take authority over this storm right now. It's hard to bind God. Father's discipline, heaven's discipline, correction, judgment. Number two, Satan's rage. Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So storms, problems, trials, crisis can come from Satan. Clearly. How do you deal with that? Bind, loose, take authority over him. Number three, sin. Your sin, my sin, somebody else's sin. Your sin has caused you more problems than you're probably aware of. I mean, I had a revelation years ago. I was like, man, I've run my own self over with a bus. Again and again and again and again. Just like, obey, stop. I mean, like, would you take your finger and stick it in a pencil sharpener? I haven't done this illustration for a long time. Would you? Oh, Lord. Lord, my God. Yeah, stop. But I like fornicating, Lord. But I like my weed. I'll be right back. Amen, Pastor Daniel. Preach it. Preach. All right. Causes of trials, crisis. One, God. Two, Satan. Three, your sin. Number four, last one. It's not in your notes, but write it down. Creation. There's a fallenness of creation, and that can cause us trials and difficulties. You say, well, which one is which when you're going through a trial? Therein lies the rub, to quote my good friend in Oregon. It's hard to discern that sometimes. Understanding God in the midst of global crisis, God is the enemy of sin. One preacher said it this way, a nation that's in sin, the greatest problem for that nation is not sin. The greatest problem for a nation in sin is God. Because when a nation is in sin, then God hates that. God is against that. He can't endorse that. And I'll just say that you can't do the things our nation is doing and not have a problem. Nations of the earth make war against God through sin, through ungodly legislation. James 4:4, adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever wants to be a friend of the world makes himself the enemy of God. So God's role in judgment is controversial. And I would caution you, and I've taken the caution myself, don't you ever think that you know what's God's judgment, because you don't know necessarily. And many people have been abused by saying, oh, God's judging you. Who are you? Who are you to say that? Don't make eternal judgments about things that you have nothing, you know nothing about. But judgment is real. And we've seen things. I've got friends. I could tell you stories the rest of the service about people who tried to hurt a church or destroy a pastor and came against them in different places. Some of them no longer are alive. So you got to ask yourself, as they attempted to hurt that church or destroy the integrity of a ministry somewhere in the nation, and now they're no longer alive, you have to ask, why? What happened? I don't know, but it could be. 1 Corinthians 3, you destroy God's temple, God destroys you. That's scripture. And we don't wish on anybody. We pray for reconciliation. We pray for peace. But there's a principle in judgment. My wife loves this. Listen to this quote. God uses the least severe means of judgment to reach the greatest number of people in the deepest level of love without violating anyone's free will or his justice in training the future rulers of the earth. He will release judgment upon you, upon me. He will do it. The least severe means to get the attention of people's hearts, to turn them, not violating your free will or his justice, to release his plan. And yet still people are hard-hearted and stiff-necked. Do you remember 9/11? You remember? Churches were full for like 2 weeks. Never forget. They forgot. Are you saying that was God's judgment? I'm not. I'm just saying that when there's crisis and hardship, it does have a tendency to draw us near to God if you respond rightly. I am not saying 9/11 was God's judgment. Let me be really clear. I have no idea. I refuse to put my mouth on whether something is God's judgment or not. I don't know. Understanding God in the midst of global crisis, God is the enemy of sin. Judgment of God has many levels to it, as I've said. Let me say this, Ecclesiastes 11:5, as you do not know the way of the wind or how the bones grow in the womb of her who is with child, so you do not know the works of God who makes everything. You are not God. I'm not God. God is in heaven. His ways are just and pure, and he is good. I do not understand his ways, but I trust him. Church, as God's covenant people, are the first line of defense. Second Chronicles, it's right in your notes, we're the first line of defense. Come on, say, we're the first line of defense. If my people, 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. So there's this the if-then clause, it's covenant language. If my people do this, then I will do this. God just doesn't do it. He partners with us, okay? If my people, he's not talking about if sinners, he's talking about his people who have a sin problem. If my people, his covenant people, turn from their wicked ways. In the book of Acts, which we preached from just recently, you'll see that the seven sons of Sceva, they tried to cast the devil out in the name of Jesus, who Paul preached. They didn't have relationship with Jesus. And as a result, they're beaten and they're naked and they're bleeding. And then it says, and great fear spread to the church, I'm paraphrasing, and they brought many scrolls and defiled objects and they burned them. Why would the church even have the scrolls and have the defiled objects? And why would they burn them then? Why didn't they burn them before? The same reason you have yours. Victory in Jesus, my Savior. What are you talking about? See, some of you think it's okay for you to do some of the things you're doing, and it's not okay, and you wonder why you don't have power. You wonder why your heart's not ablaze with passion for God. You've been seduced by the things of the world. You watch too many reels, too many defiling things, too many movies. Come on, you think that Jesus just winks at the movies you're watching or winks at your, excuse my French. It's not French. It's called a foul mouth. Suck on a bar of soap. Get delivered out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. You got to get healed. So they didn't have a fear of God. That's why. And when the fear, they said, oh my gosh, if that happens to the Sceva boys, I don't want to be a Sceva. That doesn't even sound good. And they burn all the things that they get right with God. The fear of the Lord has to be preached. Ananias and Sapphira is a New Testament principle. Oh my. The church is the first line of defense. If we will do our part, then it can literally avert crisis, and crisis can actually be turned into a blessing and God can release his power. Wouldn't that be amazing if we entered into a great revival? I mean a real revival, so much so the wings are all full. People standing outside, we have to go to 5 services. I pray for that. What would you do? Oh man, we'd preach 5 services. We'd just go for it. Isn't that exhausting? It really isn't. When fire comes on you to preach, when fire comes on you to minister, it's not exhausting at all. I could do it all day long. It's when it's dead and you feel like you're pulling teeth from people. That's difficult. That's tiring. I don't feel that way this morning. Lift your hands to heaven. Not that it has anything to do with feelings. But God is not pleased with his people who yield to political pressure. He's not pleased with people who cave into a woke agenda. We have been criticized by being very forthright here. And I can't help myself. It wasn't 3-shot mocha that got me saved. And it wasn't some half-hearted, lame preaching that tiptoed around things like abortion and same-sex marriage. It was preaching, unapologetic, fiery, anointed preaching that changed the heart of this man into who I am today, and God's still changing me. I just believe that we need to say, I don't think God's pleased when we back off of fear. What are we gonna do? Oh God, I've had pastor friends of mine that say, you know, that my board won't let me preach on abortion. You should resign, you lame duck. You know our board, thank God for our board, but nobody tells me what to preach. I'm under authority. I'm accountable for every message I preach. I've got people that listen to it and they critique me and tell me, and I've got my wife that says, hey, my wife's like the fourth part of the Trinity, thank God. No, really, I can be a little wild. She helps me stay on the beam. You need help. I need maybe extra help. How many of you need some help? Raise a hand to heaven. And I can be ungracious at times, and I'm growing up. I'm hoping to mature to say things in a gracious way. But the church needs to come alive. I'm reminded of a story. I shared it in the first service, and I'm just going to preach for maybe 5-10 more minutes. I'll be done. One of the reasons there's a demonic agenda of transsexualism that's pushing the end game is transhumanism. Don't go looking that up. Is removing God completely, becoming God so you can change your gender. You cannot change your gender. You're either XX or XY. And you're either male or female, and there's no way you can change that. And even if they could figure out how to change your actual DNA, you would still be whatever you were born and created to be, unless you're created in a test tube. And that's really scary when you begin to remove God and begin to play and actually become creator yourself. I think maybe the Lord will come back by then. I don't know, but that's where it's moving to. My son came to me at 5 years old, I'm guesstimating. I was stacking the last of the wood as the snow was beginning to come down. It's just before it snowed. It's many, many years ago. And as I'm putting up the last piece of wood in my wood stack shed there, I hear my son, "Hi, Dad." I turn around. He's got makeup, a dress, a blouse, a hat. He had clip-on earrings. I mean, he had the whole thing. And I had to repent for how I responded, but I was still right. I turned around and said, "What are you doing?" He's like, "Oh no, it's Hannah. She did it to me." I said, "Don't ever in your life do that again." Okay. I was like, and then I'm like, "Oh, that was a little extra. That was a little much." Like my children talk about the blue lasers that shoot out of my eyes. Yeah, but you know what? He never wore girls' clothes again. There's such a broken agenda that says, well, you should just placate everybody, and just as long as they feel that way. You know, I could have said, "You know something? Do you feel like a girl?" "I know, I guess." "Well, that's okay." Listen, if your kid comes to you, I feel so strongly about this. Your kid comes to you and they say, "I just feel like," if he's a boy, and he says to you, "I just feel like I feel like I'm a girl." You say, "Well, honey, you're not." He'd be like, "Feel that way? Well, let's go check." "Nope, you're a boy. You're a boy." "Well, I feel like a girl." "Well, that's confusion. That's not from God. You're a boy. You're going to be a great man of God. You're going to be a great man. Let me lay hands on you." And you get him away from who's ever sissifying him. Listen, your kids will become, you know, in these moments in the church, I just don't look at Pastor Karen. I just look over. Okay, she says I'm okay. Praise God, I looked. Masculinity is imparted. You say, "Well, I'm a single mom." Okay, I understand that. My heart goes out to you. Come and get your son involved to meet some real men of God. There's dozens and dozens and hundreds of them. So that he can teach him how to shake hands, look you straight in the face. Get him out, take him hunting. I'm gonna go kill something. My son's a man because I empowered him in his manhood. I've told him from the time he was a boy, "You're gonna be a great man." My daughter, she's a girl. She's a woman. You can empower that, or you can guide them, you can lead them. And that the challenging thing is when, especially in the Lord 48, in schools they say that and they're like, "That's because you are, aren't you?" And then they actually steal your rights, and that there's all kinds of legislation out there that's crazy. I was listening to a report from California. I think they have over 3,000 people that they're doing, that are kids under 10 years old, that they're doing gender transitions with. And many of those are without, I should say some of them are without the parents' consent.
How do we change that?
Well, I'm telling you how to change it. You pray. You worship. You take authority and you take a stand. All right, our response to the coming storms. Joel 2, 12 through 17. I've got to hurry. Joel 2, 12 through 17. God tells us exactly what to do. If you were to go to the doctor and get a prescription for some, for a problem you have, and he writes you out a prescription and tells you, just do this, take this, this is it. If you were to get a prescription for the challenges and the problems we have in America, it's Joel 2, 12 through 17. Joel was facing the impending Babylonian invasion, and we have apparently, if you believe news, vessels from Russia and China just off our coast. He said, well, they're not, oh, are you? Are they not? I don't know what they are. There's more and more possible dangers of invasion every week. He said, we'd never do that to America. With weak, lame leadership, they just might. He was facing that Babylonian invasion. They had locusts that invaded the land. We have a farming crisis. I don't know why all food distribution plants are being blown up all over America. Go look. I'm not a conspiracy theorist. I believe everything. Just kidding. But I mean, you have to ask, why is that? Why would they want to kill millions of cows and then make no longer animal protein? Now you're going to eat insects. The truth is, I don't know the fullness of what's going on, but it's clearly a crisis. I share these things with you not to line myself up with them, but to line you up with God's word, that if God's people who are called by their name, by his name, will humble themselves, turn. If we would do this, if we would come apart to understand the components of this text in Joel 2, it gives us very clear instructions about what we're to do, and here they are. One, turn to God in absolute devotion. Turn to God in complete devotion, found in verse 12. Rend your heart, number two. Rend your heart. I mean, there's a whole sermon series, all of these. Rend your heart. You know, it's a ripping. They used to rip their clothing. If they went through a crisis, they would grieve, and it was an outward sign of what they felt like on the inside. In grief, they would take their clothes and rip their clothes. That's what ancient Jews would do. So he's saying, don't rip your garment, rip your heart. It is a violent thing to rip yourself away from reels, from the thing that's polluting you. It's a violent thing to rip yourself away from the things of time and tradition and from fear, and to enter into the word and to move into prayer. Prayer is violent. The kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. He says, rend your heart. Devote yourself completely to God. Number two, rend your heart. If you don't feel the pain of the turmoil of people that are going through what they're going through, then you're disconnected. It doesn't take much when you hear the story of somebody who's transitioned from male to female or female to male, and you listen to the pain that they're in. And you sit across the table and try to counsel some of these folks, you would not be along the fence line as a believer and say, well, as long as people can do what they, yes, they can. It's America. They can do what they want. But you can't make me do what you want. In other words, I'll get vaccinated if I want to, but I'm an American. If I don't want to, I won't. I'm going to raise my kids the way God has led me to raise my kids. You can't do a stinking thing about it. It's the United States of America. Don't try to put your trans, woke, broke nightmare on top of me. I'm going to stand. I'm going to agree. I can't. It's against my religion. So who's getting persecuted now? Monis is an edgy service. Listen, if you're here for the very first time, come at least two or three more times to just make sure. All right? Oh, God. Violently tear yourself away from the things that your heart's aligned up with that's not of God. Violently tear yourself away. Your heart's funny, you know. You don't know which thing is actually going to... Some of you are playing with stuff. Oh, it's okay to drink wine, Pastor. I'd agree with that. It's okay to drink wine as long as you're not getting drunk. The problem is you step over the line pretty periodically. And so your freedom could potentially be caused. Look, some of you come from a long line of alcoholics and you just like blink that thing away. Oh, that's not going to happen to me. Really? Oh, really? It's not. Mm-hmm. We know people that have been absolutely deluded, polluted, and destroyed. And they said the same thing. I don't drink. I don't drink alcohol. I try to stay away from cough syrup. I do half doses of anything that I might feel like I need. Why? Because I will never be in bondage to anything. I will never subject myself to something that could potentially bring me in bondage. And I know how the devil works. I understand a little bit. I'm not ignorant of his devices. How would it be? You want to tell me how it would be? How would it be for our church if, so let's say that we drank wine, which we don't and I won't. I will drink it in the new kingdom with him when he serves me a cup, I guess. I know, he talks about drinking it in heaven, so I don't know, but like grape juice or what? I mean, I don't know. It's a new wine, praise God. Thank you, Pastor Karen. But how would it be? Pastor of King's Church pulled over for DUI. Oh, that'd be great. Oh, yeah. I'd be like, no, really, I wasn't that much over. I mean, I didn't even feel like I was. Oh, that'd be great. You know what? That's never going to happen. Well, how about you? Okay. Number three, have faith in God. We're talking about how to respond in the midst of global crisis. How to respond, how to respond in the midst of the storms that are coming. There's going to come more storms. How do you respond? Complete devotion to God. Number two, you get number two? Rend your heart. Number three, it comes right from the text. Have faith in God. And again, this is the remedy that Joel the prophet gives to Israel that they didn't heed. And it's applicable for today. Babylon was going to come and thump them. They had agricultural problems. They had political problems. And priests and false prophets, they had all kinds of problems. And this is what he says. If you'll rend your heart, if you'll be completely devoted, if you'll rend your heart, if you have faith in God, come on, verse 13, return to the Lord for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger. Worship team, please. His great kindness. He lists five things here. So powerful. Five reasons of why you should have faith in God. And he tells you what they are. The Lord is gracious. Psalm 103, verse 14. For he knows how we're formed. He remembers that we're dust. He's not a harsh military leader. He's not a loving slave owner. He's a compassionate, long-suffering, merciful God. He's a merciful God. And he remembers that you and I were from the dust. Oh, I repent for not emphasizing this more in the other messages, God. His love is beyond anything. He knows what you're struggling with. I've been very strong with you this day. But his mercy and his compassion that leads you to repentance. That's why we haven't been blown off the planet already. I don't know who I was talking to, but I was saying, I'm so thankful I wasn't God. You know, because if I was God, when I look back when I was in my 20s, so broken, I'd have just gone, oh, that's a stain. If I was the Lord, I'd be like, that's a mistake, right? What a waste of skin. Let's just crisp him. I'm so glad he didn't crisp me. I'm so glad I had a mama. I had a family that prayed and contended and got in agreement with the word that was spoken over our family and over the generations, that God would raise up a remnant, that God would use me. Oh God, my mother would cry out 40-day fast, 21-day fast, over and over and over, and God had mercy on me. He had mercy on me. And in the midst of crisis, God can have mercy on our country. God can have mercy on this state. God can have mercy on the nations of the world if his people will line up with his plan. Be completely devoted. Rend your heart. have faith in God. My yoke is easy, Matthew 11:30. My burden is light. He delights to show mercy. Micah 7:18. Who is like you, God? Who pardons sin and forgives the transgression of the remnant of his inheritance? But you will not stay angry forever, but you delight to show mercy. You delight to show mercy. I'm wrecked. I'm sorry. Because for me, I'm sorry. You put your hand in front of your mouth because you make ugly faces. That's why I do that. I know what he delivered me from. Somebody said, Pastor, how'd you get on fire? I don't know. He opened my eyes. I know where I should be. He saved me. He redeemed me. And what was once a waste of skin stands before you as a broken man to say, you can be healed. You can be redeemed. You can be free. You don't have to be bound. You don't have to be addicted. You don't have to be confused. You can be set free by the power of the name of Jesus. And then you can be called into glorious service. Yes. Decrees being written into heaven. Hearing them prophetically from him. Seeing them confirmed in the word. Taking those things like a two-edged sword and taking the head off of the opposition, which is a spirit. We war not against flesh and blood. In the midst of crisis, examining our hearts as a nation. How could we castrate our children? How could that happen? Because the church is asleep, but not here. Oh God.
You are more than able.
Oh God, help our country, God.
You are more than able.
I understand prophetically this. I understand that we have authority. This whole building is a little illustration. It was totally impossible. In the natural, is absolutely possible with the people who believe. It's so tiny. Nobody even knows about our little itty bitty building. But it's like the Lord saying, now, if you could do that, you could change your country. If you could, all the bombs, all the atomic weapons, all the weapons of the world can't touch God's power. His power is vast. He makes the universes. There are 50 billion universes. He makes the worlds and they spin off. He created time. He made you. He made me. He can intervene in the midst of crisis, in the midst of judgment. If the church, the ecclesia, would stand and say no more, no more, and begin to vote and get involved and serve, fast, pray. I see an army gathering before me now. I see I see a vast army of people assembling. There are people coming to Alaska like a gold rush. They're coming. They're coming. They're assembling. They're gathering. Which actually is the fourth point. Gather these times of prayer, these times of worship. There's power and authority that's being released right now. Things are changing right now. Things are shifting right now. God is releasing his decree right now. Right now. Right now. There's like an open heaven. There is an open heaven before us now. Right now. You begin to pray. Come on. Begin to say, my family's saved. My daughter's coming home. My father's saved. Come on. Come on. Come on. Pray those big prayers right now. Right now. Do it. Do it. The whole state's saved. The whole state's saved. Every village. Oh, God. Oh. Pastor Tim and Heidi, come here. Keep going. Just talk to God. What a service.
I want to lift our voices for the body of Christ to get a fresh fear of the Lord, because if people would live holy, they would fall in love with Jesus again. Things could be and would be very different. Let's come on, lift our voices for the body of Christ. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your mercy and your kindness. And God, we thank you that the fear of the Lord is even a gift that comes from you. Lord, we pray for the body of Christ, pastors, teachers, ministers, a fivefold ministry, not only across Alaska, but even our nation and the nations of the earth. God, baptize your bride with a fresh fear of the Lord. Come on, lift your voices. Lift your voices. Don't just listen to me. Even lay hands on your own heart. Lord, we pray for a baptism of fire to come upon us. Repentance. Lord, people would choose to live holy. God, that your power, people would hunger and thirst for your power. Lord, they'd seek you in prayer and worship. God, you'd fall upon your people. God, you'd visit us even once again in the name of Jesus, even all across Alaska. God, you said it. Lord, you were going to pour the oil of Zechariah across this land. God, we would be part of what you're doing. God, break up your bride. Wake up your bride in the name of Jesus.
Let me try to conclude. God is speaking to us. He's merciful. The church must obey the Lord. We must obey and take our place. We've been firmly positioned to usher in a move of the Spirit of God. It might sound like arrogance to you. It's just the word of the Lord to me. And I choose to obey it, and I mean to see it come to pass. I've pledged my life. I've pledged my sacred honor and all that I am with my family to see that take place, along with hundreds and hundreds of others. God is doing something in our midst. We don't plan these things the way they happen. This is not on our order of service. There's moments that come in God, and they might not ever come again. There's Kairos moments where time and destiny cross. We as a nation, we as the people of Alaska, are in that place right now. Devote yourself to God. Rend your heart. Believe and obey Him. Know that He's merciful. And gather. Gather. Get in. These services are important. Tonight, it's another important service. Wednesday's another one. Life groups all through the week, they're important. They're the remedy for the woes and the crisis that we find ourselves in. Praying, believing, fasting at times, worshiping, decreeing, learning His word, growing the things of God. Final, Roman numeral 5, God speaking to us, He's merciful. The church must obey the Lord and believe. Number 3, open your heart, open your homes. Connect. Get to know people. It's super important. Without that, there's no church. That's why online church is not the same thing. And lastly, we are a strategic defense. I do not understand the fullness of that word given to us by a prophet many years ago, with the power of God resting on us in Kansas City, with a man by the name of Daniel Lim at the International House of Prayer. And he said, Alaska is supposed to be a strategic defense. I understand that now. I did not understand it then. What it really means is, as we go, we'll affect the whole nation. And I mean to go with purpose and fire. I mean to decree and declare and proclaim and be a door that opens up for angelic visitation and the power of heaven, and to shut the door from the enemy. I mean to see this book here, Joel 2, 12 through 17, be a roadmap, a remedy that we will follow in the days ahead. Will you do it? Will you do it? Will you be a part of the solution in the midst of crisis? Will you? Lift your hands to heaven and just give God praise. Hallelujah. With every head bowed, every eye closed, before I dismiss, if you're not right with God, don't leave this place in that condition. There really is a place called hell. It's to be shunned. Jesus came to redeem you, to redeem me. You must believe in your heart and confess with your mouth unto salvation that he died for you and he rose again. You've got to repent of your sin. If you've never done that before, you want to give your life to Jesus for the first time, or number two, you want to recommit because you drifted. You realize, man, I better get rid of my magic scrolls. I've got a lack of commitment here to the Lord. Do you follow that? You've drifted. You want to come home. All across this place, on the count of three, give your heart to Jesus first time. Number two, recommit. Count of three, lift your hand. One, two, do it now. God bless you. Lift your hand high. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Hands all the way on this right-hand side. God bless you. Lift your hand high. God bless you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your honesty. God bless you. God bless you. In this whole middle section, lift your hand. Get right with God first time or recommit. God bless you. Both in the back. Thank you, ladies. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, sir. All the way on this left-hand side of the church, this whole section here, lift your hand high. God bless you. 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 All right. If you meant business with God, I never want to embarrass you. We want to protect your dignity. Absolutely. It's important. But we do have a theory based upon the scripture that Jesus said, if you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father in heaven. If you raised your hand and you meant business with God, step out from where you are and meet me right here. There's many people coming with you. Come on. Church, would you put your hands together for them as they make a decision? Come as close to my hand as you can. Come on, they're coming from all over. Come on, come on, come on. Sing it. Come on, come. Come on, come. Come all the way up front. You've come to the right place. It's a brand new start. Come on, come. Come. Be washed. Be cleansed. Come on. Come on, church. Praise the Lord. Come on, come. Come on, come on, come. You are more than able. Sing it.
You are more than able.
If you need to come up here and recommit your life, come right now. Come right now. Come.
You are more than able.
Come to Jesus.
Sing you. You are more than able.
Father, thank you. We give you praise. You're more than able for sure. Pray this prayer. All eyes up front, would you look at me? In this brief moment when we pray this prayer of faith, faith is confidence or assurance, is believing. Here's what happens. Everything you've ever done wrong, everything you've ever done wrong is thrown away. As far as the east is from the west. That's what the Bible says. It's washed away. That's why it's called good news. Pray this with all the sincerity of heart that you have. Say, dear Heavenly Father, come on, you right out loud. Say, dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your son Jesus to die in my place, to rise again from the grave for me. Forgive me for all of my sin and come into my life. Wash me, cleanse me, and make me new. Thank you for loving me, and thank you for hearing my prayer. Amen. Would you lift your hands to heaven all across this place and those up front? Father, now, I pray, fill these with your Holy Spirit. Break every bondage, break every curse, break guilt and shame. I pray, even for that one who has having a hard time forgiving themselves, they would see the power of your death takes care of that. I pray for that one who's having a hard time forgiving their father, they would extend forgiveness to them. Because you died for that sin. You died for that. Bless, touch, and fill these now with your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me pray for you. I ask, Holy Spirit, that you would touch each and every person that prayed that prayer out of sincerity of heart. I pray a breaking off of every assignment of darkness, any chain, any bondage, any habit that's not of God, that you would sever it and set them free. I pray and ask, Holy Spirit, touch them and fill them now and use them for your purpose and give them a hunger for your word and for the things of God. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, text us, would you, so that we can help you grow in the things of God. Text SAVED to the number 907-357-2000.
2065. If you don't have a home church, we hope that you would find a home with us here at Kings, Alaska. If you're in some other part of the nation or the world, find a good local church that preaches and teaches God's word and grow in the things of God. We love you. God bless you. We'll see you in future broadcasts or in services. Praise the Lord.